What? Don't worry about it.
That was great.
All right, 5:30, having arrived, call the meeting to order. Stand and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, first up, we're going to have a public hearing. So I'm going to recess the Board of Selectmen's meeting and open a public hearing on the acceptance under RSA 31:95-B of $18,196.25 in donations to the Town of Deerfield 250th Anniversary Committee, which came from the fair. And as follows, the Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing in accordance with RSA 31:95-B on Monday, October 19, 2015, at 5:30 p.m. This hearing shall be held for the purpose of accepting public input regarding the acceptance of $18,196.25 in donation to the Town of Deerfield 250th Anniversary Committee to help offset the cost of the 250th Anniversary activities in 2016. The hearing shall be held in the downstairs conference room of the George B. White Building, 8 Raymond Road, Deerfield, New Hampshire. And I'd just like to read into the record to the Deerfield Board of Selectmen from Jack Hutchinson, Chair of the 2050th Deerfield Anniversary Committee. Unfortunately, I will be away for the October 19th hearing on accepting the proceeds of the Deerfield 250th fair sales of commemorative items. Thank you for the ongoing support of our citizen initiative to create a memorable year of commemoration and celebration involving all of our community. Our sales at the fair were undertaken with the generous support of the Deerfield Fair Association, including free space, materials, advice, and complimentary tickets for the volunteers who work there. I take this opportunity to recognize volunteers who help prepare our booth and historic building sales area and then sell and clean up. Rebecca Hutchinson, Paul Murphy, Chuck Reese, Kathy Berglund, Edie Kimball, Janice Clark, Richard Moore, Dan Heisey, Fran Menard, Don Smith, Diane Shores, Matt Fowler, Bernie Cameron, David Watmo, Alan O'Neill, Mark Tibbetts, Mary Ellen Moran, Carol Levesque, Deb Campiglia, Dee Jones, Joan Mountford, Aaron DeBacco, Scylla Tyler, Mal Cameron, John Toby, Eric Berglund, Torrin Judd, Jack Moran, Dick Clark, Bonnie Heisey, Karen Levitt, Wendy Rappa, Lynn Hapke, and Jeff Shoup. And with that, I'd ask if there's any public input on accepting the money. Mrs. Cady.
You said that you could do it. Then Jack was going to get an account, and I do feel better with it being done this way, but is this going to raise our budget number in the default budget?
Raise it to default? I don't think so.
It's not.
It's not in the budget. It's not in the budget. It's money we're accepting to offset the money that they're going to spend.
But it'll show as revenue received, and it'll show expenditures. So it has to show up somewheres in the town budget. The law requires everything that comes in must be shown.
Per the auditors, we set up a separate fund like we did with the FEMA money that we received several years ago. The money comes in through the fund, which we numbered number 20, and it goes out through that fund, which is number 20. I would be more than happy to give you a copy of that information.
Anyone else? Fran Menard.
Jack.
Really need to go to the microphone. Sorry about that.
Jack asked at our last 250th meeting if someone from the committee could come in case there were any objections raised about this public hearing. We understood that there, if there was anything over $10,000 that was donated to the town, there would have to be a public hearing. And since we raised more than we had expected, well, we didn't have any cap at $10,000. So that's why I'm here.
Wonderful.
Any other public comment?
We do hope you accept it.
Hearing none, then I'm going to close the public hearing and reconvene the selectmen's meeting. And would anybody like to make a motion to accept?
So moved. $18,196.25.
Second.
Moved and seconded. And thanks all to the volunteers. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Money has been accepted. Thank you very much for your input, Fran. All right. Shelley, would you like to talk to us about a private road?
I think Janet gave you the plans, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
I was at the planning board meeting last week, and they advised me to just confirm with you guys that the name of the road is acceptable, and it is the name of the mountain that the house is on for the subdivision.
This is off Griffin Road?
Yes.
Correct.
By Richard Lenz.
Yeah, I think in the past we've required that there be some either geographic or historical quality to the name, and it sounds like that's there.
Okay. It's not the name of my son, so.
So you're asking us to allow the name Levi Hill Road?
That's correct.
Okay, has this been passed the 911 and?
It's going into effect now. They've actually accepted the subdivision with just, I got to make some changes to the lot plan.
What's the pleasure of the board?
I would have no problem allowing Mrs. Tatro to name her private road Levi Hill Road.
Anybody want to make a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded to allow the name of the road to be Levi Hill Road. Any discussion?
Let's hope when they make the sign, they make it red like the other.
Yeah. No, it'll be red with a private on it.
There's some confusion that it's not a town-maintained road.
No, that's fine.
All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? There you go. And Shelley, if you can just wait 2 seconds,
yeah. I think
we can give you an answer.
Yep.
On the Parks and Rec van. Has everybody read the information that we have had?
Yes.
Yep.
Basically, we've had recommendations from the Parks and Recreation Commission that they don't feel comfortable right now, and they're unanimous that we not agree to this. Mm-hmm. They're making a recommendation.
Steve?
Yes, sir.
Is it okay with the board if I give Shirley
sure.
and Jim
absolutely.
A copy of the set agreeable to each other?
Yeah.
Answer a lot of questions, but
you'll have something a little more permit.
Is that a copy of this, Andy?
Yeah.
Okay. Huh? Plan for what? There you go. We have I'll just read a letter from Joe Manzi to the Deerfield Board of Selectmen. At last night's Park and Rec Commission meeting, we discussed the use of Parks and Recreation 12-seat passenger van by the Deerfield Community School or its agents. I expressed to the commission that while we try to be as accommodating and helpful as possible, I do not support this request. Simply put, the van is an important resource to the department. It was purchased by the Parks and Recreation Department to support these programs, which funded the purchase through our revolving account. I see no equitable way to share depreciation and maintenance of the vehicle across the two groups, nor to know that it will be unavailable to us when we need it for our programs. We try our best to maintain and preserve the van so that we may be able to safely utilize it for as long as possible. Several concerns were raised by the commission, such as having to have it certified as a school bus and therefore requiring a school bus driver, but my main point is as presented above. Regarding a secondary issue of providing transportation with the van from the school to the after-school program, I also do not think that workable. We cannot guarantee that we could have staff or the van available to make such runs while servicing the 70 or so children that we have here in the after-school program. We have no excess staff, and we use the van for our programs. Commission members were unanimous in their agreement with the above and the thoughts further recorded in the minutes of the meeting. I would be happy to respond to any further questions you may have regarding this matter. So basically, I would say that if the board is in agreement, based on that recommendation, we'd have to say no at this time. Any other members want to make a comment? Okay. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Thank you anyways, guys.
Thank you. All right, let's talk budgets. First budget is the cemeteries. Bit of an increase.
Sorry.
The proposed budget is $21,452, which is $5,000 more than last year, and I see the number in
trees.
Tree care. Yes, we need to take care of the trees. Is everybody okay with that one?
Yeah, I think we're definitely going to need increased
tree care. We're way behind, I think.
Where's Don now?
Don? You just happen to walk in when we're talking about the cemetery commission. And the addition of $5,000 for tree care.
Yes, for tree and cleanup of cemeteries that haven't been cleaned for many years. Maybe never been cleaned, for my knowledge.
Quite possible. All the members of the board are in agreement that we need to do something and spend a little bit more money. Any other questions?
No, I think that's a great idea, Don.
That's a great idea, Don.
Okay.
Thank you very much. All right, the Heritage Commission. We're up 250 to 850.
Website maintenance.
Any questions?
No.
We're good, Fran. Thank you. Advertising and regional associations. These are the dues for the NHMA at 3732 for this year, and we expect that to go up?
Possible.
We don't know.
We're not sure 100% yet.
Yeah.
Very good. Supervisors of the checklist. $6,151, which is a 2012 dollar increase. Mm-hmm. Everybody okay with that one? Number of elections changed.
Yeah, we can't do anything about it.
No. Zoning board.
Josh is here.
$3,891, up $1,232. Increase in a ZBA part-time employee from 650 to 1356. Anybody have any?
Josh is here.
Josh is here. There he is.
You could tell us.
Undercover.
See, undercover. Yeah. Josh.
Yes.
So I think, you know, the labor for Jane's time is up this year, and also printing and or legal notices and postage and printing. I think we about 4 years ago, if I'm not mistaken, we raised our application fees with the idea that while the zoning board should be providing a reasonably accessible service to the citizens, that the fees should largely offset the cost of the certified mailing, the newspaper postings, and all the legal notices. And I think we're still really on par to do that. You know, Jane's time, our secretary's time, really depends on the caseload, the difficulty of the cases. We had a little bit of correspondence this year, which I think pushed us up. We've really had fewer applications in the last year. Going forward, who's to say?
Josh, the as of the 15th, of the 650 budgeted for Jane, you've only used $215 of it.
Is that what the other sheet shows?
That's what I'm looking at right now.
Yeah. So the 13, I noticed the number that's in the budget for the secretary has changed from what I had put in $1,300 in the sheet I submitted back in July? June?
Yeah.
And now the sheet that up to date is showing 1357.
Just about, at a rate of 1723 an hour.
So I'm not quite sure if you're looking at $250 used to date, where that number's coming from.
I'm looking at 215.38 as of 10:15. That has, how many, do you have a number of hours that you're budgeting for?
No, I've always just sort of looked at what it was the year past and mm-hmm. gone from there.
Okay.
So the rate, I know there was a raise given out, but what I'm not clear on is why the 1357 has changed from the 1300 I put in. Or is that the cost of living raise?
That was the raise increase.
Excellent. Okay. So I think what I was looking at was that last year we had very few applications. The real estate market seems to have picked back up. There's additional subdivisions going in again. So I expect to see more variances being applied for. That's just a hunch based on past experience.
I think he's definitely right with regard to new subdivisions.
Mm-hmm.
It works out to 78 hours.
It's not much.
That sounds like it's not much. Okay. Anybody have any other questions?
Yep.
Thanks, Zach.
Josh.
Yep. Zach, Josh. I'm out of my mind. All right. Planning and zoning. We're looking at the planning board. $37,975, $2,565. We have the chairman of the planning board here. Fred, what's the...
Major increase in the budget is due to the board wanting me to put in for reorganizing our files in the room up above. Apparently, when the new windows were supposed to be going in, the fire department had come in and taken and rearranged the files, and apparently they're permanently rearranged. And so our secretary has said that it's very difficult to find things, and that's the reason for putting that money in. But we had estimated 120 hours, basically 3 weeks worth of work to put that together. I talked to Judy Marshall to see if she was interested, and she said thanks, but no thanks. So we'll have to find somebody else if we go ahead with that. One other item. A couple other items. The town of Chester had Southern Hampshire Planning Commission look at the possibility of including fire and police in their impact fees. And Southern New Hampshire hasn't finished with that report yet. So I'm hoping that what they'll come up with is something that we could conceivably end up using ourselves and possibly include fire and police in the impact fee calculation that we end up doing. And that's carried in under the consultant budget. So the possibility of having them do that. And finally, on our equipment, I talked to Jan, and I had carried in there a stackable steel roll tube file for $320. I ordered one of those today, slightly less than the $320, so we could probably look at, and I also, we got a donation of a five-draw filing cabinet that's supposed to be coming in, so that we could probably just drop that line item to a dollar for next year.
That's, you wish to do that now, or?
Yeah, you might as well.
Which line is that?
That's,
equipment. 740.
740, yeah. Third page.
So drop it to a dollar?
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions for Fred?
How's your workload, Fred?
Well, as Andy was mentioning, we're definitely seeing an increase in the subdivisions. Apparently, Jeff White's project, somebody was saying that most of his or all of his have sold, lots have sold out. And so we've had just an eight lot, seven or eight lot for, I can't think of the guy's name up.
Mr. Pelletier.
Pelletier, right. And I'm glad Dick's here can remember some of these things, but that I can't. And we had another one coming in off of Mount Delight Road for seven or eight more lots. Seven lots, I guess it is. So it looks like things are starting to pick up.
Great. All good.
Everybody knows it, watches it.
Go ahead, Jeff. On your first line, you get employee, part-time employee line.
Yes.
You've assumed 450 hours at $17.23 an hour. It's going to come up to $81.40.
No, I think that's that the 81.40 reflects the increase, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. So you'd have to, I'd have to change that 17.23 to whatever the new number is.
Oh, I got you. All right.
Let me check my math on that, huh?
Anyone else?
Thanks for all you do.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Ah, the building inspector. $51,496, an increase of $2,174. I see that's due to the raise. Any questions while the building inspector is here?
Excuse me.
Any questions for us, Rick?
No, pretty much the same as it's been.
Yeah.
Very little change in it.
How many miles on the truck?
19,004.
I think it might last another year.
Oh yeah, the rot will do it in before it's worn out.
Tire's good?
Yeah. That might be a bad one on it now. Something's going thump, 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 thump. I haven't figured out what yet, but I will.
Any questions for the building inspector?
At this time.
Thank you, sir.
No, Jasper.
Well, yeah. I'm sorry, let's look at your other hat. Transfer station. Bottom line, $234,101. We're down $1,001. Is that the total?
No.
Solid waste disposal total. One more page. One more page, yes. Transfer station total. Stop for a moment.
375.
375,426 up. $29,303. Where are the new expenses, Richard?
I believe we put the paving back in there for $25,000.
And maintenance and repairs?
Pardon me?
Maintenance and repairs?
Yeah. And then I don't believe it's in here, but I'm looking to add about another probably $7,000 for a container. The tire container is junk. We had to use the loader to pry it open. It's rotten to the ground, essentially. I'm waiting for some prices to come in on a container, but looking at past prices, a container that size is probably going to come in around $7,000.
Heavy equipment container loader?
Yeah, it would end up going in that line typically.
So right now it's at 6,000. How much you figure you got to add to that?
I'm going to say 7.
An additional 7,000.
Yep. That line is actually pretty much all expended this year. We had a breakdown on the large container, on the large compactor. And it pretty much consumed most of that line for one breakdown.
Go ahead.
Roughly how many tires a year, Rick, do you think get dropped off?
Tires?
Tires.
Oh. This year, we're around 400, I believe.
Is it a fee on every one, or is there
some? Yes. Actually, we've got a new vendor. We're getting $3 a tire, and I think our new vendor is charging us like $220, $225 a tire. We found a new vendor.
Good.
The drawback is our old vendor used to supply the container and move the container back and forth. The new vendor doesn't supply a container. He charges us less for the tires, but he doesn't supply a container. He just comes and physically empties the existing container by hand and loads them into his truck and takes them around. But because he's cheaper, we've been going with him, and he gives us better service. But we found that keeping them stored in the container and so forth is a lot better than people throwing them all over the ground.
Yeah. Makes a big difference, I imagine.
And they're not visible at that point, and so forth.
Okay.
And some of it reflects salary increases as well.
The payment line. I wondered if that shouldn't be pulled out as a warrant article.
How does everybody feel about that?
May not get done. It needs to be, right?
Budget doesn't pass again. Get done either, right?
I mean, it's a
I guess it's a catch-22 one way or another.
It's a maintenance item. It's paved. Right. We've already paid to pave it. If we don't do something to recoat it, we're going to lose what we have. I see this as a budget item. It's ongoing to keep the transfer station operational. Everybody could pretty much imagine dirt.
No, I agree. I'm just trying to think
The
best way to get it done. So.
That's just my opinion.
I know. I think in the past, we've sort of presented items that we didn't think had to be done as warrant articles, and there's been some general understanding of that in the community, and it, I understand exactly what you're saying. It would be nice to get 25,000 out of there, but I think it's probably better to leave it in.
It's the third largest budget that we have. If we don't take care of it, it's going to go bad.
Get a chance to revisit it. Nothing's final.
Yeah, I mean,
we're just going through
I put it in there because looking at the pavement, it's starting to break up a fair amount. Mark has looked at it. He feels it's beyond the point of seal coating. Can we get a couple more years out of it? Yeah, but that's why we're starting now, for the fear that I don't know when it's going to get passed. You know, if it takes 3 or 4 years to pass it, and we go too far beyond, then we might be faced with tearing it all up and completely repaving it again. I mean, reach a point where you just can't top coat anymore.
Let me get a feel from the budget committee as to what they think. We've got a meeting Tuesday. Not this Tuesday, the next Tuesday. But.
Okay.
I may have some preference.
Anything else on the transfer station?
Most of it.
All right. Thank you, Rick. Highways and streets. Go to the bottom line, highway department total. $820,154, up $78,794. Mark, you want to hit the highlights?
Mostly winter maintenance.
What's your page number?
43.
Yeah, that's the final number.
Do we have enough sand there now to get the year started?
What's that?
Enough sand stockpiled now to get
I think so. December. Get to the end of the year, yes.
Good.
And you're proposing the warrant article too, Mark?
Yes, for the, because we've been using our road reconstruction line as kind of what we've been running over in the wintertime. And I'd like to put a warrant article in for the winter overage for that.
Quick questions. I don't know, Mark or Jan, do we have to make it a snow expendable trust, or can it be like a weather related? Because we've gotten kicked just as badly in the road reconstruction. For the flood, for the tornado, for various other things that have caused exactly the same problem. So if there's a possibility to broaden it so it's a weather-related expendable trust, might serve us.
Yeah, but we go, what we have here for salt and sand and contract just doesn't, even on a regular winter, just isn't enough.
No.
You know what I mean? So it's going to get chewed up
right
in the winter, you know.
I can look into it, but what I did was I put out a request from other towns, and this is what came back.
Yeah.
And okay. The town that I looked at, their warrant article was for $500,000.
Well, if this is the best definition, I'm fine with it, but if there is a chance to broaden it a little bit, we've certainly had exactly the same problem happen because we spent, an extra $80,000 clearing
trees. I know what you're saying, yeah.
Expect okay. To.
So the possible language I'm looking at is to see if the town to vote to establish a snow expendable trust fund, purpose of managing winter weather, including but not limited to plowing and removing snow, sanding and chemically treating streets, and otherwise responding to hazardous road conditions related to winter weather, and to raise so-and-so. But that does say specifically winter weather.
Yeah. Just thinking, if we get a flood in May or...
Maybe you could just take out winter. Hazardous road conditions and to raise appropriate.
Hazardous road conditions related to winter weather, take that out and to raise and appropriate. That probably, check it out.
Check it out.
Do we want to cap this? At a certain number?
Just because it'll roll year to year.
Oh, from year to year.
I'm thinking we're looking to ask for how much right now? Do we have it decided on the number?
We were looking at about 75,000.
So cap it at 100?
Yeah. I think that's, as Marcus pointed out, it's not going to be there anymore.
Yeah,
that's right. About the overage that we burned through, so.
Right. Okay. How's the knotweed spraying going, Mark?
Went well. It's all this year's treatments done.
Mm-hmm.
Was able to get the permits back in record time.
Wow.
And they sprayed week before last, I think.
So I assume that you're planning on them coming back for $3,000 next year?
Got to come back in June and then again in the fall.
Good.
Any other big chunks of road reconstruction beyond South Road that you're planning?
Out of my regular road reconstruction budget, I'm planning on doing Griffin Road this year from the town line to James Road. That road is really...
Seen better days.
Yeah.
And your part-time employees?
I don't have any right now. I'd like to get one for the winter time.
That's your on-call?
Yeah, they're on-call, yeah. Would be on-call.
All right, and also we're looking for a warrant article to see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $243,000 for the reconstruction of 4,500 feet on South Road from house number 57 to house number 100. Warrant article will be offset by impact fees in the amount of $30,000 for 2,250 feet. Further questions for the highway department?
We doing contracts later?
Yeah. So I was going to do them when we were done, while we're here. All right. So, Mark, I have all the winter contracts here. Have everybody you need?
Yep, everybody's coming back that we had last year.
Good deal. So I have Gary Sanborn, John Winslow, Mark Tibbetts, Kevin Fisher, Mark Young, Paul Smith, East Coast Signals, Steve Rollins, and Kevin Young. All of them need signatures. Those are your guys?
Those are my guys.
And all their paperwork is in order.
Yep.
You make one motion?
Please.
Make one motion for the list of plowing contractors that were read off by the chairman.
Second.
Approval.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Anybody have any other budget ideas? Any questions or information they need to have for next week? Good. All right, so our next appointment is Aaron DiBacco. Thank you, Mark.
Yep, thank you.
Did I get that right, Aaron? Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Welcome.
At a previous meeting, it was recommended that you could help us work on getting our message out.
Is that all?
Mm-hmm.
No problem. So I'm Aaron DiBacco. This is loud. I live at 81 Griffin Road, or as the world knows it, Jane Miller's old house. And I think this happened because Jeannie and I were talking about this program that I know about, which it's called New Hampshire Listens. It's run out of the Carsey Institute at UNH. And what they do, it's a very small office, but what they do is they create and staff and support opportunities for people in towns to talk to each other about civic issues, whichever issues are important to that town. And what New Hampshire Listens owns is the process, the way of doing it, techniques that are known to work. But it comes up from the town, what's talked about, and what's done with that information later. So I was talking to Jeannie about this, and she said, well, and then she came to, I think she actually called me after she talked to you guys. She said, well, what about this? So, and I put together a small information packet. I don't know if you guys had a chance to look at it. Okay, I know you're very busy. It described the process and what could be done here a little bit. And I'm here to answer questions, and if you guys want to move forward to take it back to New Hampshire Listens, what I thought would be helpful is to clarify my relationship with the organization, which is non-existent, basically. I mean, I know them, but I'm not in the group. And I'm starting to work with them as a facilitator, but I'm not on the team that orchestrates everything. There's paid staff, and I am not on paid staff. There's a couple of people, a guy named Bruce Mallory and a woman named Michelle Holt Shannon. And so what I am at the moment is an information carrier. I know what they do, and it seems like it would be a really interesting process, perhaps useful, to deal with this question of the safety complex or other things that came up. Towns have used it for many different things. Raymond used it. What I was told informally is that they used it to learn how to speak to each other with more civility and to do things in a more civil way as a town. They had a different thing they called it there. If you had a chance to look at the website, you'll see that there's about half a dozen towns around here that have all done different projects. Some of those towns then create a team, which would be Pittsfield Listens, Concord Listens. It could be Deerfield Listens. So there's a standing group of people who, when an issue comes up that would benefit from some thoughtful, deliberate conversation, there's a structure in place to have that conversation in the town. And what they do is they bring people together, they put together, so there's advertising, which here is complicated. I can't figure out how you guys tell each other things are going on yet, but I'm sure that after I've been here 6 months, I'll know. So I lost my train of thought.
Something after 6 months.
Huh?
Something after 6 months.
No, I was making a joke about communication channels here and my lack of understanding of them yet, which, since I only moved here in June.
There are some who say that there are no communication channels, but pretty much you can find out anything that goes on in this town through the grapevine. But we need a better way of making our case or talking to the people.
So
certain issues.
Right. So this would be a good way to do that, I think. And so the way the process works, because I would be curious if I didn't know anything about it, is a town will decide what is it that they want to have a conversation with themselves about. And then New Hampshire Listens, or the people who works for them, will put together a package which says, here's how the process works, here's the relevant information. If you're going to have a good conversation about this, you need to know what are the real costs, what are the options, what are their costs, what are their benefits, what is the history? You know, we've had two votes on this issue in the past. The first time had this result, the second time had this result. So that when the people are sitting in the room talking, they actually have a body of knowledge they're talking from, which makes it a more productive conversation. And the first round of conversations happen in small groups, 8 to 10, so that everybody gets to be really heard. And there will be generally not more than 3 or 4 questions that have been identified before the meeting as important. An example of a kind of question that might be addressed was the one I put in here. To give people a chance to identify the most important considerations for decision makers to keep in mind regarding police, fire, and safety services in Deerfield. So that's not a yes or no question. It doesn't say, here's one thing we can do, you know, up or down. It says, here's the problem we have to solve. Here's the information that we have available. What do you, as the people who will ultimately be paying for this and living with it, care about? Mm-hmm. And then that information gets collected onto one sheet of paper, which then goes back to the decision makers. So easy to read, I know you're busy. And that goes back to the decision makers, who then can say, we now know that what's important to people in the town is this. Or we have two trends, and some people feel this, and some people feel this. But here's why, and here's what's going on with them. And then you can make a decision that's informed by what matters to the people who live here. It takes they generally happen in the evenings. They take 3 hours. If you wanted to see one, Dover is having two, one tomorrow and one next week. It's a candidates forum. But they're going to be using that facilitated process. Everything in the world comes down to money, it seems. And this can happen a couple of ways. There's one-time events, which is what I'm suggesting here, to see if it's culturally suitable to Deerfield to collect information about what works for the town in this way. So one time, and then if that really feels good to people, then perhaps we could create a Deerfield Listens. You know, so there is a standing group of people to run this kind of conversation. But you're not committed to that if you want to try this. So there's a one-time event. The support of New Hampshire Listens, they bring the expertise, they bring the structure, they write the report that comes out at the end. They said it's hardly ever more than $2,000. That cost mostly goes away if I take on the New Hampshire Listens role, which I would be willing to do. So a lot of the facilitation, organizing the structure of the thing, writing up the report afterwards. However, if I'm doing that, I'm not allowed to pull together the town side of things. So there would have to be another person involved. What we need from the town, as we talked about in the information I gave you, is to create the space to pull together. The most important part is to pull together a group of people who care about the issue, who have information about the issue, to help frame how the group will talk about it when the event happens. And in New Hampshire Listens calls that the steering committee. And so they come up with the key questions. So you don't want to just invite the people who all like this answer. I'll bet that there's somebody or some people in town who care about the impact on taxes. And that person needs to be in the early conversations so that that perspective is taken into account. I personally don't know who else would have to be there for it to be a good conversation, but I'm sure that people in this room do. So the steering committee says, all right, who do we have to bring together to plan it, and when should we have it, and where should we have it, and what's the timing of this, and what questions do we want to ask people? Then it gets set, and then the letting people know about it, right? I was talking to Jeannie. I said, I heard about the art fair from the day I started unpacking my boxes. I had to work really hard to try to find out when the coffee house was happening, right? So some mechanisms work really well, and some are more informal. But clearly, it's possible to get that information out. And you don't need to have a huge turnout to have a big impact. Because if people know it's happening, they'll be thinking about it. And then if you have 20 to 40 people come, then you write about it, it will help stimulate the conversation, even if a relatively small number of people were there. so that the event happens, a report is written up saying this is what we did, this is what we were told, that comes back to you guys, and then it's done until you want to do something else. And I will answer any questions that I have may have overlooked.
I don't have any questions in particular, but the process sounds very similar to what happened with the design charrette for the center of town here, which there wasn't immediate action after the design charrette, but we did end up with a new town field, a bandstand, some vision for the center of town. So I like the idea of this process, and that certainly attracted a more diverse group of people to the table than we typically had information gathering. So this sounds like a great idea to me.
Well, and if that was successful and people feel good about what happened, that would be a way to help people understand what this could do, right?
Yeah, I think very much so.
So what would our first step be?
You would say that you're interested. I am meeting with them tomorrow. I'm going to Dover, and I told Jeannie, I'm either facilitating, taking notes, or being trained. I'm not sure what they have in mind for me, but I will be with them. And I can say that you're interested in moving forward, and I need to know. I'm perfectly willing to facilitate this in any way that makes sense. my husband will be upset that I said that, but it's true. So if that means creating a relationship with them and being the Deerfield person who speaks to them, who speaks to the organization, then I'm willing to do that and sort of the specifics, the nuts and bolts of the next steps. If you would prefer to perhaps save a little money and have me do that, then we'd have to talk about who would be willing to pull together the steering committee and arrange the logistics of the event and the publicity. Because there has to be somebody who's willing to do the work to make that happen, right? So, and I'm also willing to do that. It might take me a little longer because I know maybe four people in town, but
I think that's a real plus, though.
I was going to say, at least.
I mean, I see two pluses here. One, you mentioned cost savings, but I think your face coming to this as a facilitator, no one's going to have any preconceived notions
right.
about whether you're in the fireman's camp or whether you're in the policeman's camp or whether the selectmen have got you out there running interference for them. Or you're going to be a completely fresh face.
I don't even know what it is people might think I think. So when they say, you think this, I will really look utterly innocent and ignorant. So, okay.
Good so idea. Then we would have to think of someone who could be the front person for setting this up.
Somebody like Rebecca or Jeannie.
Well, I love negotiating and being in a situation to facilitate. I love collecting people's ideas, but I think people would be thinking otherwise that I would not be able to be neutral. I mean, this is so, even though I would feel personally very comfortable and very excited to do it, I don't think that I would be the right person for that.
That's very graceful.
Yes.
We'll take that as
especially
it's
time.
Rebecca.
All right, so why don't we start with, we're interested.
Okay,
we'd
good.
We'd like you to be the facilitator.
Okay.
And let's go forward with the next steps. And in the meantime, we'll brainstorm and try and find someone to start the
or some ones
right. And they will be supported.
Mm-hmm.
They're not going to have to invent it from scratch because there's a really effective and smooth model that they'll be able to draw on.
So let's take this first step down the road
and
work towards getting this. And I really appreciate you coming in and explaining to us and taking the time. Welcome to Deerfield.
Yeah,
thank
welcome.
You thanks. I mean, and if other questions come up, are you Jan?
Yes.
Hi, Jan.
Jan.
Jan knows how to reach me.
Okay.
So if other questions come up, or if you feel like you want a little bit more information, or if you find someone who's interested but wants to talk more about what might be involved, just put them in touch with me and we can go from there.
Great.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thank you
Thanks.
Very much.
Thank you.
All right. Outstanding minutes. Or do we have something else? Thank you.
Crank through them.
All right, outstanding minutes for the 5th of October.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Jeannie, thank you.
You're welcome.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Payment accounts payable manifest in the amount of $45,796.97.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. My favorite bill. The county warrant in the amount of $523,540.
Is that compared to last year's?
I bet you it's up.
It's up.
Those are just our notes.
Yeah. So we're going to pay this on the last possible day.
You got it.
All right. Can I get a motion?
I just need another signature on it. That's why I gave it.
All right. Can I get a motion for me to sign the okay for the warrant for $523,540 to be paid to Rockingham County?
I would make that motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. The chairman of the 250th anniversary celebration has written a letter to the governor inviting her to our 250th anniversary celebration on January 9th, 2016, which was the date the colonial legislature and Governor Benning Wentworth signed a petition to set off a district parish. The evening will open at 6 p.m. with dinner at the Great Hall of our community church. We'll move to Town Hall for the reading of the 1766 petition and the act of incorporation signed by the governor. Anyhow, they'd like us to add our signatures to this letter.
Great.
It's the Senate campaign.
Sign up.
Type the imprint.
The police chief has submitted the following two names, Eric Baker of Rochester and Alexander Mollett of Raymond, as probationary one-year police officers for full time.
Motion to accept.
Second.
Police chief's recommendation.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, so Mark Young has given us new numbers for the 2015-2016 year for rental of your equipment.
That's the same as what last year was.
Okay, $2,800 a month for a loader, $60 an hour rental for the loader. This is all for the loader, right?
It's all for the loader.
Okay, $60 an hour or $2,800 a month.
You know what?
Either or. Yeah. $60 an hour, yeah.
Motion to approve Mark's proposal.
Second.
And now, if I could just add for the chairman to sign that.
Sure.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
When does that start, Mark?
November through April. All right, CAI Technologies contract for the time period of 1/1/2016 to 12/31/2016, mapping services for the town, total of $1,800. Was that the same as it was last year?
Yes.
Yes.
A motion for us to approve and sign the contract.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? I think that's been a fantastic service that they provide.
Particularly where we're linked with the Avatar tax cards now.
Yeah.
More valuable, I think.
All right, so last week we talked about a poll petition, or 2 weeks ago, rather. And at that time, the highway agent had not approved it. I assume that he has now. Mm-hmm. The one on Middle Road, Mount Delight Road.
Got a bunch of sites they flagged.
There's a bunch of sites, but my understanding is that this is just for the one on Mount Delight Road with four copies.
All of us, an issue.
Why don't we make, as part of your motion, that the chairman signs it, makes it easier.
Make a motion that the chairman signs the agreement about the new poll on
Mount Delight.
Mount Delight Road.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any questions? All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Technical service support agreement with Physio Control. This is for
the new piece of equipment that they received, the Lucas.
That's for rescue.
Oh, for rescue. Rescue, yeah. $6,200 a year,
mm-hmm,
for keeping it up to date and, mm-hmm, and supporting it. Wow. All right, can I get a motion to approve that contract?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded, and that's for me to sign. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Request from the town clerk. On October 13, 2015, Russell Simmons came in to do the town only portion of a truck register. Turns out that he renewed the wrong truck. I am requesting a refund and check in the amount of $197.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I have a timber tax levy in the amount of $260.79 on David and Elaine Nelson of Nottingham Road.
Make a motion that we levy the timber tax.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Request from Steve Gemelli to surplus the highway printer. It's a Dell 1720DN printer. Motion.
I would make a motion that we surplus the highway department's printer.
Second.
Recommendation to Steve Gemelli.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Note for the record that on the 9th of October, three members of the Board of Selectmen approved a payroll manifest in the amount of $61,433.58, which netted at $47,617.67. On the same date, the same three members of the Board of Selectmen approved an accounts payable manifest in the amount of $336,715.73, of which $250,000 was for the school. I have a notice of intent to cut wood or timber on North Road for William Magarg and Carrie Hawk to 228 North Road. Just above me.
This recorder would be on you, wouldn't it? What's that?
Yep. Thanks, Jeff.
That's where Buzzle's garage was.
Okay.
I think that's already been cut.
Yeah.
It is. So I was confused.
That's interesting. So you got the doors put on?
Yep.
Very good. Very good. The new building down at the highway shed.
And the
grader actually fits inside. That's an amazing thing. Okay, has everybody read the tax information on this property? The owner has requested a reduction in the interest on the liens. There hasn't been a payment since 2014. House is being sold. At this time, I'm not interested in reducing it.
Yeah, I think the only times we've reduced it have when there have been active efforts so to work with us prior.
Everybody's okay with sending a letter back that at this time the Board of Selectmen are not willing to reduce the interest. Is that correct?
Yeah. I'm comfortable with that, yeah.
Okay. Thank you. All right, so a quick update on Middle Road. We're waiting for the court. This is the decision has been logged in, but the court hasn't been able to get to it yet.
We need a judge to actually sign off.
Yes, we need a judge to sign off, and the court is running about a month behind due to staffing issues. So right now, We're waiting. Thank you. Tell me about Primex and non-employment compensation.
Those are next year's figures.
Our contribution is going down $1,109. That's
yes.
A good thing. So last year our member contribution was $2,754. Next year we're expected to pay $1,645. Excellent. And our property and liability program renewal.
We're in a multi-year agreement on that, aren't we, anyway? So it's just an automatic renewal.
Remember, our contribution is going up from 4633 to 49553. And the workers' compensation renewal program. First one I was unemployment. Now we're in the workman's comp. Again, going from 3642 to 33178, an increase of 8.3%. Some good, some bad. Ah, yes. The wetlands permit for the Northern Pass. So what action do we need to take? This is just a notification?
It's a notification. There is a thumb drive with that for the board to look at anything that they want to.
2,000 pages.
No. That's something altogether
That's
different.
That's something different. I'm sorry. Yes, it is.
That's the application for the wetlands. As I said, the thumb drive is with it because there's over 4,000 pages involved in the application. And so if the board is looking for a specific page, I will contact Catalina and she can get you a page so we don't have to print it out.
Is that one location?
That's the entire.
That's the whole thing, right?
Isn't it? Right. You can pull that down.
No.
For the whole
state.
The whole. Right,
multiple. Town or city is multiple.
But they have to do it for every single town that
Clark.
They go through.
Right.
That touches any kind of water.
We should probably let the Conservation Commission and the Planning
they
Board.
They already do.
Know that we have this on file.
They already get a copy of it.
Good. Lovely.
So that's for information only at this point. We're not acting on it.
There's nothing we can't act on.
You don't act on that one. And that is basically the same thing coming from the attorney.
Mm-hmm. Just know that it's here and it has started. We had contact between a loader and the 2015 Ford dump truck?
Yes.
And how much damage?
It's on the back.
It's on the back.
Blank page. Next page.
It doesn't have it.
Where'd that happen, Mark?
Transfer.
At the
I'll
transfer.
Get you the
so it's the town, the transfer station.
Was the transfer station driving the loader? All right. Any real damage to the?
It was bent in the back panel with the lights on the very back of the
bumper. Yeah.
That's all the paperwork.
That's all.
Rough idea to fix it. How much to fix it?
This was more to put on record.
Oh, no.
Than
yeah.
It was
oh,
to
right.
be be repaired.
So we don't have to approve any dollar amount?
All right. Town Administrator's Report.
As seen on the news, Northern Pass Project has filed with the state. Catalina gave us a packet today, and again, with another thumb drive with the balance of probably over 40,000 sheets of paper. She is going to let me know as soon as it's available online and where, and I will let the board know. We can also put it up on the website so that anybody that wants to go to whatever site it is, it can be there.
And this is the SEC application?
Yes, it is. It's the Transmission Project SEC docket number 2015-06.
What's going to the Site Evaluation Committee?
Yes. The question I have for the board is, would they like me to contact David Witham from Primex to do an evaluation of the police department like we did with the fire department?
I think that's a good idea.
Great idea. Okay. Give us a little notice so we can attend.
At public like we did the fire department too.
This summer, I heard on the news that the state received FEMA money. So far, we have not received our FEMA money, so I've spoken with the state, and I was told that within the next 3 weeks or so, we should be receiving a letter and then the money for the FEMA expense from the highway department, at which time Penny and I will do what we've done in the past for the FEMA money, set up the 45 fund, which we're using for the FEMA money. We will have a public hearing to accept the money, and then I will be taking the specific expenses from the highway department, moving them to the FEMA fund, and depositing the money. So Mark will be getting a little bit more money for his budget, so he will not be expended. I've had several calls in regards to Route 43 from the Candia line to basically the Briggs's Field where they shimmed the road, asking whether they're going to be repaving or if they can put some lines down. I called the state, District 6, and they said that they would look into this for the town, and if anything minor, they would put some of those reflector strips. And I did say, well, that's all well and good until the first snow, and then
they're all gone.
As you saw, the doors are on at the garage. In regards to the concern of the floor at the town hall, Mark Tibbetts and Gary Young went over. They pulled up one of the top boards. The boards underneath that are fine, so they're not sure what is happening, but they are going to replace two boards in the hallway and two in the main hall. And Mark is thinking that it could possibly be because there's no air circulation under
that
the
part
town
of
hall
town, yeah.
Because when they put the addition on, they took the fan away, so they're thinking they're probably going to have to put new fans in. But they will be purchasing new boards, milling them, repainting them, and then putting them in, and they'll be back in by the weekend. And the work on the side of the Parks and Rec building is going very well, and Gary should be done within the next week.
Questions for the town administrator? Go ahead.
Yeah, I'd mentioned this to you earlier, Jan, but in regard to a property on Nottingham Road, 123, I think we took ownership of that probably 2 years ago now. I went by on Sunday and hadn't been paying much attention, but it appeared to me that there was smoke coming out of the chimneys of at least two of the mobile homes or trailers or what have you on that property. So we've clearly got people living there, and you know, I don't know exactly how the board wants to proceed, but a couple of years of ownership and we've got tenants, I'm not sure if it's the owner or who it is.
Let's have the building inspector, code enforcement guy go down there and let us know, and then we can make a decision.
Yeah, we need to move on it.
Okay.
Anyone else?
All set right now.
Thank you, Jan. All right, any unfinished other or new business? Go ahead, sir.
Tailgate trick or treat Sunday.
Cool.
Anybody's interested?
At the
fairgrounds.
Fairgrounds?
Yeah, noon to around 12, 1 o'clock.
That's 25th?
Yep.
All right. Anything else? All right, I'm going to. All right, let's go into non-public under E.
Okay, I'll make a motion that the board goes into non-public session RSA 91A3 Roman 02E. Consideration and negotiation of pending claims litigation.
I got a second.
Second.
Yes.
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 I'm going to mention to the audience that this might not be that long. Or
yeah, we'll be
minutes.
Now.
All right, note for the record that no action was taken. Can I get a motion to seal the minutes of the non-public session?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Yes.
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 Yes. All right, can we go into non-public session under
C?
C, please.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that the board goes into non-public session RSA 91A3. Roman numeral 2, letter C. Matters which in discuss in public would likely affect adversely the reputation of any person.
I get a second.
Second.
Yes.
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 Yes. All right, we know for the record that no action was taken. Can I get a motion to seal the minutes of the non-public session?
So moved.
Second.
Yes.
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 Yes, thank you very much. I believe. Citizens' comments. Yes, citizens' comments. Yes, ma'am, please step to the microphone.
You put your hand out.
Probably did.
didn't want to hog up the space. Oh, no. Just a couple of questions about things. I'm just not sure how they work. When you all go into a non-public session under the C, and then you say it's because what would be discussed could possibly affect someone's reputation. Am I saying that right?
Correct.
Pretty much.
Right. So then how does... do you tell the person you're talking about that you'll be talking about them? Because my understanding, tell me if I'm wrong, my understanding is the person you're talking about has the right to say they'd rather have it in public. Am I wrong about that?
In some situations, I believe that is the case.
Correct.
Yes.
I thought it was all situations.
No.
Like any time you were going to talk about someone under C, that the person always had the option of it being made in public. Is that true? That it's always their privilege to have it talked about?
No. It's not true that it's always their privilege. The Board of Selectmen have a right to discuss the employment, the hiring, the firing, and assorted other things first before something becomes public.
So you don't have to tell the person that you're talking about that they're being discussed, right?
In that aspect, I believe that it's correct. We don't need to tell the person.
If you're making a decision prior.
If we made a decision, yes, we would have to tell the person, but we haven't made a decision. We discussed.
So when, so a person never knows they're being talked about. They only know after you made a decision that, hey, we did talk about you, and this is the result. Am I understanding that right?
I think you're convoluting the situation. In an employment situation, the employers have a right to discuss the performance of the employee.
So in that case, then, it's you don't have to let them know.
It's becoming way too much back and forth. Please make a comment on how you feel about it.
Well, my comment was I just wanted to understand what, you know, what that meant when you guys do it, because you do it almost every meeting. So I just wanted to be sure I was clear, you know, on the aspects of that. And the other one, a question I had, and probably you know this, is where do we do all of our banking? Do we have like a bank for the town, you know, just like one bank that we do business? Or do we have more than one?
We actually have two banks.
Oh.
The majority of our accounts are with TD.
Oh, TD North.
Yeah, TD Bank. And we have a money market account with Citizens.
Oh, okay. I just didn't know. Thank you.
Any other citizens' comments? Ms. Gating?
Can you put the Northern Pass thumb drive on the town's website so a citizen can look through it?
It's too big for our website.
How many megabytes of memory?
We may be able to put a link to Northern Pass's site, because I believe they're going to have it soon. They don't have it up yet. But we could certainly put a link to the Northern Pass site where the information is.
Well, that was going to be done. But as soon as Catalina gives me a call to let me know exactly where it is, I will have Steve put a link. That had already been discussed earlier today, because I know the residents want to see it.
And then I have a further comment. Approximately a week and a half ago, I asked the town treasurer to, under the right to know, let me see the accounts of the two banks. And she has not answered.
She did.
Okay.
She did send you an email, because I was copied. Okay, they're in my office. You may come and see them tomorrow. And that's what she said. And I also, because she was not sure if you had received them, she asked me to resend you the email. And I sent it this afternoon.
Excuse me.
Gosh.
Well, they are there.
Call ahead.
And it should be with the treasurer.
Any other citizens' comments? Mr. Verville?
Oh, no, it's okay. I didn't know if Harriet was going to use it, so I didn't know.
Hi, Kevin Verville, McCarran Road. So the last time we talked, it was relative to the safety complex questionnaire that you guys mailed out. And I apologize, I was late to this meeting. Have the results of that been tallied? Are there numbers on that?
We have them, yes.
Have they been publicly announced? I showed up late, so I didn't know if it was discussed.
They were just distributed to the Board of Selectmen.
We haven't had a chance to really go over them. But yes, we have them. And they're
maybe he could swing by the office and get
Yeah, I would love to be able to make a comment on to actually what they said, but I think you have to read them. They're all over the place.
Okay, that's not really that surprising. Anyway, so the last time I was here, I was asked my opinion on the status of the firehouse, right? The main station, central station, whatever it is we tend to call it. And I told you I couldn't give you an answer because I had not reviewed that facility and really didn't want to give an off-the-cuff answer. But I did promised the board that I'd go down and take a look. So I called Chief Tibbetts, and he was kind enough to host me last week. And so they were very gracious, very welcoming, gave me a fairly thorough tour of the facility. So I can tell you what my takeaways from that were, and I think I can give you some more general opinions that may or may not help guide you through the future. It is a very cramped space. There's absolutely no doubt about that. So unfortunately, the lollies that support the second story of the building are not in line front to back. And so it makes maneuvering very difficult with large equipment, because you basically have to pull in straight, jog around, and go back in. These are things I know you all know, but I was not aware of. And I try to pay attention. And so maybe if people, you know, listen to this at home, they'll get a better feel for what it is. Because of the cramped conditions, you know, not everything's at the front door, right? So if water rescue is required, equipment has to be moved out of the way to get to the rescue boat, things like that. There's a very limited space to work, which, you know, the chief was very honest and forthright that in the summer, really, that poses no challenge. They pull the trucks out, they work on them in the yard, they put them back in, everything's fine. The challenge they have, of course, is in the winter months, right? Because it's 20 degrees out and there's a howling wind and 4 feet of snow on the ground. Nobody wants to be out in the freezing cold trying to service a fire truck. So the space is certainly fully packed. There was discussion that the facility is not large enough to accommodate stock modern fire equipment. And in touring the upstairs, that became a little more obvious to me what that really means. So the building as it exists today is essentially circa 1950s, right? And fire trucks in the 1950s were much smaller, and that facility accommodated them much better. You can see them on Thursday nights down at Candia First Stop when they do the old cars, people bring out old fire trucks. So new equipment doesn't fit in. So the downside to that is if you want to put a new piece of equipment in, you're essentially ordering custom. And we didn't get into numbers. I'm not sure he had numbers as to what the added cost is to essentially downsize a fire truck to be able to fit the existing space. So that was a question left unanswered. The real question is the space adequate? Right, that was sort of the cut to the chase question. And I'm going to tell you what my knee-jerk answer would have been. And if I pretend I didn't go on the tour, still can be. And this is the challenge that you have trying to sell something different to the voters of Deerfield. The station's circa 1950s, and it has met or exceeded the needs of this town since then. And so the fiscal conservative, sort of like the way things are, view of the world would be, what quantitatively has changed that would necessitate a change in space? And that's the message that has to get out there. How you do that, I don't know. That building is fully packed. I can imagine the difficulty of somebody trying to get ready to go to a fire. Essentially, they said, we jump in the trucks, we go to the call, and we suit up on site, because there's no room to suit up within that building and then get into a truck. Some of the older trucks don't really allow for that. Anyway, there's not room in the cab. They were nice enough to show me into particular pieces of equipment. The newer equipment allows for somebody to suit up at the station and get in the truck. And I'm going to assume that saves time, especially in the winter time when the weather's not very nice, trying to get into that suit and get the boots on, et cetera, would be difficult. So certainly one can make an argument that just based on space constraints, something probably should be done. Exactly what that is, I'll leave to the discretion of the board. And I didn't prepare notes tonight, so I apologize. I usually do, because it keeps me from rambling. But you still come back to 18 months ago when an idea was floated and went down on a vote of 2-1. So anything moving forward, somehow we have to find a way to communicate the need effectively. My guess is it's probably largely built around cost. And I thought about it a little bit, and I remember sort of the pictures, right, of the front of what was proposed, and it was a modern safety complex. And when we say those words, I know there's people out there that'll say, well, they have safety complex envy, that they look at other communities that have built large safety complexes, and now they want to be the next ones to do it. And if that's true, then you have to deal with it. If it's not true, you have to find a way to explain around that. Because if that's the mind picture that people have, then that's what you have to fight. The other thing when I see a modern fire station. I see a big, modern, very industrial, sort of like the old 70s shows of the Los Angeles police and fire, right? Because that's what those buildings still sort of look like. And I can't help but wonder if the picture that was floated was a more folksy, sort of in keeping with an older town look, if that almost wouldn't make it more palatable. Basically a facade, right? Because it's the inside's going to be what it is. I reviewed the report that you'd gotten from the third-party auditor, and the thing I'm always nervous about is that the language that gets tossed around, and I'm not sure what the correct language is because everyone uses different words, are those things legal requirements, or are they the state-of-the-art recommendation? If they're legal requirements, that's one discussion to have. If they're state-of-the-art recommendations, and to give you an example, a decontamination room or a fire suit isolation room, things like that, then we really have to be thoughtful and mindful of what we're doing. Because the question is, does Deerfield need a state-of-the-art, every modern recommendation up to the T, and how often do we have to reevaluate that to make sure we're sort of keeping up with the modern code? And so, well, you wanted an answer. I'll give you a thoughtful answer. But because I know the select board wants a new fire station, and I'm telling you what some of the pitfalls were. Right. And so these are some of the things that I recommend that you really think about and be able to articulate, because if you don't articulate those things, you will have the same result if it appears anytime soon on the ballot.
Could you put those on notes and give it to us? Because so far, so good with what you're saying.
No, I prefer to keep the comments probably oral at this time. I'm sure because I'm just here as Joe Citizen tonight. But I'm sure if something comes before the budget committee, I would vet it out much more thoroughly. And that's, I think people got sticker shock, and I don't think Deerfield is ready for the full-blown safety complex. To that end, when I left the fire department, it was enlightening to me. So I reached out to the police chief, and I've scheduled an appointment with him actually to review those facilities as well. And that's actually scheduled for tomorrow night. I wasn't planning on being here tonight, but my schedule freed up. So the fire department, long story short, the fire department would certainly benefit from added workspace in and around the vehicles. How one gets there, how one bridges the gap, there's a lot of different ideas besides the full-blown safety complex. So I would really encourage lengthy, open, public discussion repeatedly by this board and other boards that are affected by it, so that people have the opportunity to hear the comments, to hear the thought process, to have the tough questions asked and answered. And I think you'll probably end up with something that everyone could finally agree on. That was sort of my takeaway with it.
I appreciate the fact that you came back to us.
So, well, I made a commitment, and if I say I'm going to do something, I certainly try to do it. So I would ask if you guys have any questions beyond that. I'd be more than happy to have a conversation. It doesn't matter to me. Otherwise, I'll...
Citizens' comments.
Were you here when the woman was here talking about New Hampshire Listens?
I only got the very tail end of it. I apologize.
Would you be interested in helping with that, maybe? You get a lot of good points, and it might be really helpful. We'll talk about it more when we get some.
Yeah, I didn't hear the presentation, so it's sort of hard for me to commit onto something that I'm not exactly sure on. But if I get a chance to watch the earlier part of this meeting,
it's going to firm up a little more as we move forward.
Yeah, certainly. It sounds like you're still sort of in the feeling out stages anyway.
You can check them out online too, see what they do.
Shut them off.
Yeah, trying to.
Not that Please. We don't want to hear you, Kevin, but we regularly limit people.
To 3 minutes. No, I understand.
I appreciate that you came back, and I'm very glad you're also going to go see the police department.
Right. Good news.
From that side of the desk, I suppose it'll be a more pleasant visit. That's as good as the jokes are going to get, guys. Thank you.
Yeah.
One more, sir.
Yeah, I actually came to speak on a different topic tonight, but I guess after listening some of the discontentment while you're in session, what I actually want to comment is I appreciate all you giving your hard-earned time off to come here and serve the citizens of Deerfield. I really appreciate that, and thank you for your efforts.
Thank you very much. What's your name?
John Cinnamon.
Treasurer's husband.
Anyone else? Mrs. Katie? Ms. Katie, it's been asked that you go to the microphone also, please.
I just wanted to bring your attention to Johnson versus Northwood, where the Supreme Court ruled the employee had a right to be present when he was spoken about in non-public or to have it in public.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much for coming.